Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back to the channel. Welcome back to another episode of the Disney Plus Project. So this week we watched Artemis Fowl, which we had both read, actually the first three books before we watched it, right? Yeah, we both finished the third book, and I had started the fourth one. So we had done our reading beforehand. So
I regret reading beforehand.
Yes, we'll get into that. But before we get started, make sure if you are not subscribed to the channel, make sure you hit that subscribe button. And if you enjoy the video, make sure you leave us a like and a comment down below and let us know how we're doing. And give us any suggestions on Disney Plus movies or TV shows to watch.
Yeah.
So, Artemis Fowl. I think last week at some point had told Anna, because I went and looked at the Rotten Tomatoes review of it, just because I was curious to see the scores. Because from my experience, a low critic score means a slightly higher audience score. And it's pretty rare for, and vice versa. And it's pretty rare for that not to be the case. It's pretty rare to have a high critic score and audience score and a low score with a low score. But I went and looked at the Rotten Tomatoes for Artemis Fowl, and it was a critic score of 10% and an audience score of 20%. So this was one of those rare occasions. And so my immediate reaction was, oh, people are probably just overreacting. They're probably just, like, wanted it to be exactly like the book, and it wasn't. That's usually what happens.
Were they overreacting?
So then I decided to look at the, like, synopsis of it. And one of the first things I saw in the synopsis of this movie was what immediately made me think that it was probably not going to be the greatest. And this part of the synopsis said, it's based on the first two Artemis Fowl books. And immediately that right there for me was like, okay, this is not going to be so great. Because if you try to mash two books into one, or three books into one, like they did with Series of Unfortunate Events, mm-hmm. before they did this Netflix series, and it just ends up badly.
Yeah.
So I went into it thinking it was probably not going to be the greatest. And it was within the first 5 or 10 minutes that both Anna and I were like, this is, wow. Like,
yeah, I'm a little bit shocked because Disney has the money to put into this.
Yeah.
And it feels like it was done by like a B movie.
A 12-year-old?
Yeah. Yes, honestly. Mm-hmm. It feels like it was like a 12-year-old's, like, fifth grade project imagining of a book that they read. Yeah. It was like they hacked way too much into such a small space.
Yeah.
That, like, you didn't, this is something I think that got me, and it's why I wasn't invested, and I actually didn't even finish watching the whole movie.
Yeah, you left about 10 minutes from the end, roughly.
And it's like throughout that movie, they don't give you any time to build a relationship with the characters.
Nope. And you do not care what's going on with these characters.
No, it's just like, here's another person, here's another person, here's another person. You care zero about these characters, and you don't know why you should care about them. You don't know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
They make bad guys out to be not bad guys, to an extent. And
which one?
Artemis Fowl. He's really not a good...
No, he wasn't a good guy.
He's not, like, he's the main character, but he's really not the good guy.
No, he's the protagonist. He's not a good guy, he's the protagonist.
But, like, throughout the movie, they're trying to make you, like, think he's, like, some, like...
That he was a good kid and that he's just doing this because of what happened with his dad.
Yeah, but he's really not. No. And there's just so much of it that got convoluted.
Mm-hmm.
And like, even aside from, like, knowing what is in the books versus the movie,
mm-hmm.
You just feel no connection to anything in the movie.
Yeah. From my perspective, it was... Looking at it solely as a movie itself and not a movie based on a book, it was borderline okay. And that's giving it a lot of credit.
Yeah.
It is a movie that I would watch it again, but I'm not in a hurry to watch it.
I probably would never, like, ever watch that again.
It's not something that I'm going to go out of my way to watch again, but I would watch it again if somebody wanted to watch it. I'd be like, okay, dig your own grave, but, you know.
I'd say, see you later, let me know when it's over.
But it is really sad because the books were really, really good.
They are so good.
And to have something like this, it makes me think of the Aragon days all over again. Because I read the Aragon book before I went and watched the movie in the theater, and I watched it in the theater. And it was, that one was bad, and it's kind of the same thing that happened with this.
But let's be real. If you could, like, if you had a holy grail of book adaptions, mm-hmm. what would your holy grail of book adaption be?
What do you mean?
A movie adapted from a book. Uh-huh. What would your holy grail, like, best, they did an amazing job.
Oh.
What's your holy grail?
You mean as far as them doing a good job actually following the book?
Following the book, or...
Or just doing it well.
Both. On both tracks.
I would say that would be the Lord of the Rings movies, all six of them, and the Harry Potter. Because while they left out a lot of stuff and changed a lot of stuff in both Harry Potter and Lord of the Rings, they did the movies so well that it didn't matter.
Lord of the Rings was what I was gonna say. Mm-hmm. And look how much money and time and effort they put into that.
Yes.
And even Harry Potter, time, effort.
Mm-hmm.
And
millions upon millions of dollars.
Right. Like, I've not seen any book adaptions done as well as those two. I don't even think I've seen one that comes close. I think, like, I'm looking at the bookshelf. That's what I'm doing. The Hunger Games wasn't bad. It wasn't great.
They did a good job, but yeah.
But it wasn't bad. But then, like, I'm looking at, like, all these other ones, and honestly,
mm-hmm.
the only other one that I can think of that they did a decent job on is a one-off book. It's not even a series.
Yeah.
And it's Great Gatsby. And the newer Great Gatsby.
Yeah, I never saw the movie.
But, like, I don't feel like any other book adaptions have ever been good. Mm-hmm. And so it's really, like... And I'm typically pretty good about sorting out
mm-hmm.
book adaptation versus movie.
I'm really good at separating the two, at seeing them as two separate entities. Because I've been writing for so long, I can separate and go, okay, this is one medium, this is another medium. You have to do different things. There are certain things that you can't put into movies because it doesn't translate well from what the book was. Because it doesn't translate well from, like, your imagination into being on screen.
Which is fine, because did I actually have you read Blood and Chocolate? Or
yes.
Did you... Okay, so that's always my big prime example of don't judge a book by its movie.
Mm-hmm.
Because I love Blood and Chocolate, the movie. I thought it was well done, but it's not the book.
Mm-hmm.
And I treat them as two separate entities, and I love them each for their own thing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that I would ever be able to separate Artemis Fowl and the books. The movie and the books.
Mm-hmm.
Because they did such a terrible job.
They made it really, because of what they did with the movie, they made it really hard for us to separate it. Yeah.
Like with Blood and Chocolate, they have such a different storyline almost. Like, mm-hmm. they didn't follow the same storyline. Mm-hmm. Like, really the only thing in Blood and Chocolate that was the same were the character names.
Yeah.
Honestly. But when you look at Artemis Fowl, they tried to use character traits that were the same. They tried to use all the characters that were the mm-hmm. same. And they very vaguely followed the same plot line.
Yeah.
But they changed so much key stuff that it makes it hard... that they made it so hard to truly, like, enjoy the movie.
Yeah. Well, I think a big part of it was there was two things that I think were their downfall. And one was their treatment of the characters. None of the characters were really done right. No. The only one that was kind of the only couple of them that were kind of okay was, surprisingly, I didn't think this was going to go well, was Josh Gad as Mulch.
I thought he did a really
good
job.
I did not think he was going to do that great. He did a really good job as Mulch.
Yeah.
And then, actually Dame Judi Dench as Commander Root. I think she did a good job. Well, the kid that played Artemis did a good job.
He did a good job for what he was asked to
do. They just wrote the character wrong in the movie.
Yeah, he was totally...
But they mess up all the relationships. He didn't really have that great of a relationship with his father in the book. His father was a criminal mastermind, just like, Artemis Fowl became.
I think that's what kind of irked me about it. Mm-hmm. Is they tried to sugarcoat the movie.
They did.
Everything is
they tried to give him a good relationship with his dad, and...
And he wasn't really a bad guy when he mm-hmm. really was a bad guy.
Mm-hmm. Like, he was... Within the first few chapters of the first book, he was compared to a monster.
Yeah.
Like, they called him a monster. And he didn't care.
And, he
flat out didn't care.
And, Holly was not supposed to be, this... Just, she's, a sweet little girl in this movie. And that's really...
Yeah, no, she was a captain in the police force in the book.
Yeah.
She knew what she was doing.
They sugarcoated this movie.
Yes,
they
did.
And that's... I think that's maybe
they were trying too hard to make it, a Kitty Kinney movie.
Which is silly, because the Artemis Fowl books are middle grade. They're mm-hmm. not, this is, end of elementary school, beginning of middle school level book. There's there's really not difficult themes in the book. Mm-hmm. There's not difficult words. The only thing that's difficult about it is that not all the words are in English.
Oh, yeah.
Because
there's a little bit of Latin thrown in.
And yeah, because they're supposed to be speaking a different language, so
the fairies are, yeah.
Yeah, so that that makes sense. But that's the only difficult part about it. It's really not difficult, because you can make up however you want to pronounce those words. they're not real words.
The other thing you see is the foul motto. The arum is est potestas, which is gold is power. That's really the only thing you see that's not in English. The rest of it is just assumed, it's kind of established at the very beginning that the fairies are talking in their own language.
Yes.
And that they essentially switch to whichever language.
So, it's not a difficult book. There's not really mm-hmm. any difficult themes to deal with in it.
Yeah.
And so it's frustrating that they would even try to sugarcoat this and dumb it down, because that's what they tried to do.
Yeah.
It didn't need it.
Yeah.
It did not need it. I don't know. I'm really upset by this. Can you tell?
Yeah.
They just...
I mean, I am too. Yeah, they did a terrible job. If you've read the books and you go to see the movie, it will be god-awful. It will be absolute garbage.
I think you can not read the books and...
And it will still be bad.
It'll still be bad.
It just won't be as bad because you don't have that...
Background
of knowledge. And so it was not well done, and it was very disappointing. That's why I was I need to do some research and find out, but I'm not honestly sure if Disney was the sole one working on this movie. I was wondering, I had asked her beforehand, I was I don't know if they were doing it themselves or if somebody else had already been doing it and they acquired the rights later. I don't know.
Man, I would not, this sounds awful, but I wouldn't have wanted to put my name on that.
No. Absolutely not.
That's not something I would have signed off on.
Yeah, Kenneth Branagh should be very disappointed. So, he should want to hide his face. He should be embarrassed about what he put out.
Yeah.
He really should.
It really was awful.
I had such high hopes for that. Because it was I had never read the books before. And then I saw it and I was oh, that's really cool. Because I really like the Percy Jackson books. And they turned those into movies. And I actually enjoy the movies. They didn't follow the books very well, but I enjoyed the movies. Because they actually did a fairly decent job, but they just
I think it's just too far. They mm-hmm. they used too much and too little.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It was a really big disappointment, and I'm kind of sad that Disney was willing to put that out.
Yeah,
to put their name on that and put that out.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of disappointing to me.
Yeah, as you're watching the movie, you have no idea what's going on pretty much the whole time, because they were trying to combine two storylines from two books into one, and they were trying to combine the storyline from the first one with little bits from the second one, and then the ending of the second one kind of, and it was just...
And into the third one, it was...
They had a few elements of the third one. And actually, at least one or two elements from the fourth one, I've come to realize since I've been reading that one.
Yeah.
They have that thrown in there. And it's just why would you do this? Just make one book at a time and you would have been fine.
Yeah, or done it.
Because not only are they shoving two books into one, but then they make it an hour and 20 minutes long? You can't shove two books. They made three movies out of a 250-page Hobbit book. 300 pages, whatever.
Yeah.
But that they turned into three... 3-hour-long movies. 9 hours of stuff they got out of that single book.
And I
plus a little bit extra.
And I honestly think that Disney could have done a movie per book series, done it well, and kept their audience.
Yeah. If not doing a TV series type thing like they're going to do. I'm pretty sure it's Disney Plus that has the rights to the Percy Jackson, because it's going to be remade as a TV show for a streaming service. But it's going to, because Percy Jackson is going to be Percy Jackson is going to be remade as a TV show from streaming service. It's still not been officially announced that it's Disney Plus, but
it's probably Disney Plus. Because who published it? Hyperion?
Disney Hyperion published the books.
So yeah,
and then it's Disney Plus. I believe Fox maybe was the ones that made the two movies. I believe it was Fox. The two movies are on Disney Plus. And so I believe it was Fox that made the movies. And so they now have the rights back.
I think it is.
But that honestly should have been what they did. Because they could have done a better job. Do a series of unfortunate events like Netflix did.
Yeah, do a series of it. That's what I was going to say.
Because that was amazingly done.
Yeah.
It was so well done. Do something like that with Percy Jackson and with Artemis Fowl. Could have been great.
Yes, and you got... Then that means you have longevity in your audience. Mm-hmm. And that means that you have those new subscribers, too.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know that there's people who wanted to watch Artemis Fowl, so they subscribed.
People that read it as kids. Like, the first book came out when I was in elementary school.
Yeah.
And so there's people that have been reading them for a long time and wanted them to be made into the, like... There are huge amounts of books on this shelf that I would love to see made into movies.
Oh, yeah.
And so that's what everybody wants.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know, it was disappointing. It was very disappointing.
Very disappointing.
So.
Would not watch again.
For me, I would avoid watching again, but I would watch it if I didn't have a choice.
Nope.
But Anna wouldn't.
I would let somebody else sign their death sentence.
But, so yeah, that is our rant about Artemis Fowl.
And totally thankfully
we were actually able to keep it spoiler free. I mean, there's really not much spoiling about it.
I was gonna say it's not really like.
Again, you have no idea what's going on, so there's really nothing to spoil.
Yeah. There's nothing.
I can tell you exactly how it ends, and you still probably wouldn't spoil anything. Like that's kind of how
they
badly it's done.
They all lived happily ever after.
And then got shot in the head. No, I'm.
She
didn't actually see the end, so.
No, it didn't hold my attention. I was like, I was done.
We spent most of the movie talking to your mom about how badly they did the movie.
It's true.
So that's our little rant about Artemis Fowl. So next week, hopefully we'll be able to sit down at some point this week and watch Hamilton. That's what our goal is.
It's our goal.
Because we really want to watch it anyway.
Yes.
Because we enjoyed, Newsies that they... record the Newsies on stage that they recorded. We really like watching that. So hopefully we will be able to sit down at some point and watch Hamilton this week, hopefully. But it's 2.5 hours long, so it'll be a little bit of a...
Yeah, we're probably going to have to watch it on our own time.
Yeah, on our breaks and lunches over the course of a few of these next week.
Yeah,
so.
We're not going to be able to just sit down and watch it together.
Thank you all for joining us this week. Hope to see you all again next week for some Hamilton. And until then, don't forget
to thank the Phoenicians.